Hello, and welcome to Lesson 1. This lesson is about scientific paper structure. Now, let's talk about where this lesson fits into the overall scheme of the project management approach to writing your scientific paper. So, we are in the initiating phase, looking at scientific paper structure. And after this lesson, we'll start moving into the planning phase before we get to the rest of the project. The learning outcomes for this lesson are as follows. At the conclusion of the lesson, you should be able to first explain the purpose of each section of a scientific journal article. You should be able to explain the overall structure of a scientific journal article. You should be able to identify key elements or notice and identify when there are missing elements or obscured elements in a published journal article. And finally, you should be able to outline your journal article. Let's talk about how scientific papers are structured. Most papers in most journals follow the MRAD format. So what does MRAD stand for? MRAD is an acronym. It stands for Introduction, Materials and Methods, Results, and Discussion. So let's talk about the purpose of each of these sections of the journal article. The introduction is there to provide the context for your work. It's going to let your readers know where your work is coming from. It's going to let your readers know how your work is connected to previous research. It's also going to let the readers know what the purpose or the hypothesis of your study is going to be. And so it sets up the expectations that they have for the rest of the scientific article. It's an extremely important section to get right if you want to write a coherent and cohesive journal article. The methods or materials and methods section is there to let your readers know how you did your experiments, what materials you were using, and if it's not obvious, in this section you will explain why you chose certain methods to carry out your experiments or your research project. The results section is there to interpret the data. So data is not equal to results. Results are data that have been interpreted in the context of that experiment or that part of the project. So the results section is also there to help the readers see how you've interpreted that data, and it's going to present the figures and tables in a way that they follow it as the narrative of your paper unwinds. Then the discussion section is there to interpret your results. So you're interpreting the results in the context of your field and other previous research that has been done, and also in the context of your research question, that is, your hypothesis or your purpose statement for this particular study. Also in the discussion, you're going to discuss the implications and significance of your findings. And you're going to include a critical analysis of your study, its strengths, its weaknesses, the unique aspects about it. You're also going to look into the future and say what should be done next. So at this point, I would like to step back a little bit and just think about what we're doing in science. So in science, we follow the scientific method. And you can see in this figure, which I've pulled from this scienceschools.us website, a very simplified version of the scientific method. Now, this figure was meant to educate children, and you probably saw a very similar figure when you were a child first learning about science. And so this is how the method goes. First, you ask a question. Then you do some background research, construct a hypothesis. You test the hypothesis by carrying out an experiment, then you analyze the results and draw a conclusion. Now, this conclusion will either support your hypothesis or it will not support your hypothesis. So you can say the hypothesis is true or correct, or it is not correct. If the hypothesis is not correct, then we have this loop where you go back and you rethink the hypothesis, you change it with your new knowledge that you have, and then you test it again, you analyze the results again. Once you have an answer, it's time to report the results. Now, this is a diagram for hypothesis-driven research. Not all scientific research is hypothesis-driven. Some of it is driven by technology development and other kinds of development types of studies, knowledge discovery, for example. And a hypothesis just doesn't work for those types of inquiries. So we have another structure as well. And this structure is for those purpose-driven types of experiments. And it's very similar. You notice how things are now, and you identify a need. You do background research. You propose a new method or technology. You develop a way to solve the problem, and you test that method or technology. Then you analyze the results and draw a conclusion. Either it works or it didn't work. If it didn't work, you go back through this loop to propose a new method or technology and go through the process again. So it's very similar to the scientific method, but it doesn't use a hypothesis. So having been a scientist for a long time, I can say that this chart is pretty much accurate for the way we work. Now, we don't think about it necessarily in these terms as we're going about our jobs as scientists. But I think when it's time to write the paper, it's good to think about this simple scientific method again, because it corresponds to the way that journal articles are structured. They match each other very well. Well, the introduction covers the first few parts, the asking a question, the background research, and the constructing the hypothesis or purpose statement. Materials and methods and the results covers this green circle where you test with an experiment, and then the discussion covers the rest of it, analyzing the results to draw conclusions, discussing whether the hypothesis is supported or not, and reporting the results. One of the things I want to do in this course is help you write a good scientific story. And when I say story, I don't mean fiction. I'm not at all encouraging you to make anything up or cherry pick your data and leave out things that are inconvenient. No, I'm not saying that at all. By story, I mean a true story, a true and complete story that is interesting. It has a narrative. It moves from one step to the next step to the next step, and people are interested in learning about it. That's what I mean by a good story. Let's talk about how to structure a good scientific story. It's going to set the context in terms of current knowledge. It's going to clearly define the unknowns or the knowledge gaps that will be addressed in that study. And it's going to let the reader know what to expect by having a clear research question. It's going to be simple, but not simplistic. As scientists, we really like to overcomplicate things. It seems to be in our DNA. But when you sit down to write your paper, make sure that you're not overcomplicating things. You know, simplify it as much as possible so that you can have a nice, simple story. Additionally, a good scientific paper is going to be concise. That means it's no longer than it needs to be. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's short. It just means that there's no excess words, no excess verbiage in the story. It's as short as it needs to be and as long as it needs to be. Also, a good scientific story is going to answer the research question that was posed earlier, and it's going to fill in the knowledge gaps or the unknowns that were mentioned earlier. And lastly, it's going to identify new knowledge gaps.